سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزي عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. أما بعد، we are continuing to apply the Quran to current events as to show how much relevant it is for our living, for our decisions, for our future. This is a central issue, and I'm hoping that by the end of this series we will get to appreciate the Quran more and give it more time and more attention, more thoughts and more reflections. So this is the purpose of this. In this ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, and we are focusing the application today and last week on the French reaction to the redeployment of the Danish cartoon by Charlie Hebdo magazine, and how President Macron and others have reacted to the whole thing. Here is a series of ayat that goes to the deep roots of the answer to the question they raise and we do not raise. The question they raise is, why do Muslims hate us? Why are Muslims full of hate against the West or Christianity or Judaism or anything? The Quran tells us the truth, and the truth is what the Quran says. وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا حَسَدًا مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنْفُسِهِمْ. This is what the Quran tells us, that many, كثير means many. So it's not a fringe, as we are led to believe. It is many. From the top leadership, from politicians to church leaders, to media personalities, anchors, writers, philosophers, down to the layperson. Many of the people of the book, they wish to turn you back as kuffar after you have believed. They want you to be like them. They want you to be a Christian or a Jew. And the Quran doesn't hide this. The Quran says, وَقَالُوا كُونُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا تَهْتَدُوا. Be a Jew, be a Christian, so that you are guided. What you're following is what? A crazy person, all of the labels they have. The Quran says, this is not about them doing da'wah. This is about حَسَدًا مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنْفُسِهِمْ. It is an envy that is deep-rooted in their hearts. And this is something that we need to understand so that we deal with the issue wholesale, not retail. Wholesale means you deal with the root cause of the issue, not the symptoms and the appearances of the issue. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that they are doing this مِن بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الْحَقِّ. This is after the truth has been made clear to them. And he tells us فَعْفُوا وَاصْفَحُوا. What is عَفُوا? عَفُوا is not to punish when punishment is due, and you can punish. It's an amazing concept. The Quran is telling us, do not punish, even if you can. Wasfahu, open a new page. Why is the Quran telling Muslims to do this? The Quran is telling Muslims to do this because as humans living on the same planet, we have to try to work to help everybody understand the truth. And once we engage into animosity and counter animosity, there is no way nobody would listen to you. So even though this is their wish for us, what we wish for them is what Allah says, ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة. Allah wishes them guidance. But Allah also tells us, ليس عليك هداهم. It is not up to you, O Muhammad. It is not your responsibility, Muhammad, to guide them. You cannot open their heart and shove the faith into it. Leave this up to Allah. ليس عليك هداهم ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء. So no matter how much you want to guide people to Islam, share the message and let them enjoy the choice that they choose. This is your responsibility. So what was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent to be? Allah says, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا وَنَذِيرًا. Here in Surah Al-Fath, in another place he says, وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا. We have sent you as a witness, a good news giver, and a warner, and a preacher to the truth, and a illuminating light. This is the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then what about the response? Allah says, لتؤمنوا بالله ورسوله, so that you, humanity, may believe in Allah and His Messenger. وتعزروا, and to support Him. وتوقروا, and to respect Him. To hold Him to the honor Allah has honored Him to be His Messenger. وَتُسَبِّحُوهُ, which means to praise Allah. وَتُسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. So this is the summary of the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then in Surah Al-Ma'idah, it uncovers the root of their hatred of Muslims. قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ هَلْ تَنْقِمُونَ مِنَّا. Do you hate us? Do you envy us for anything but that we believed in Allah and we believed in what has been sent unto us and what has been sent down unto you? And then what? وَأَنَّ أَكْثَرَكُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. And the fact that the majority of you are fasiqoon. You look all the vices in the world, and everybody could do their own observation. I don't pretend to give you my observation. But look at your observation. Where is vice most spread? Where is evil most spread? Where are wars initiated from? Where are the mayhem, the killing, the stealing of resources of others, the oppression of people? Where does it come from? It's not from Muslims. It is not from Muslims. And the fact that the Quran tells us this, وَأَنَّ أَكْثَرَكُمْ فَاسِقُونَ, that the majority of you are rebellious and disobedient. The facts of reality tell us that atheism, agnosticism, all anti-God sentiments, projects, ideas are not born in the Muslim community. They could be imported, They are transferred and implanted, but they don't come from the Muslim community. This ayah also raises another question. And by the way, Islam is only one of 1,000 religions on the face of the earth, maybe even more. Why is Islam, why is the God of Islam, why is the Prophet of Islam, why is the Quran, why are the Muslims the only speck in their eyes? Why all the attacks are directed at Muslims? And Muslims barely have the power to respond to anything. Look at Afghanistan, look at Iraq, look at Syria, look at Yemen. Very fragile communities have no weapon industry, we have no military industry, we have no rockets, we have nothing. And all weapons these countries have are imported or smuggled into these communities. Why do they focus on destroying these communities and then label us as terrorists? It just doesn't get inside me. I cannot swallow this. But we all need to understand when the Quran speaks, we need to understand what the Quran is saying and why. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. This is a decisive, definitive message. وَمَا هُوَ بِالْهَزْلِ. It is not a joke. It is talking about our fate, our future, our relationship with our neighbors and with communities and nations that we have to deal with, and what we need to understand and how we should behave. To understand what this statement here means, you need to go back to Surah Al-Baqarah, to this ayah. It says, وَلَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ. We've sent down unto you, O Muhammad, clarifying verses and signs and miracles. وَمَا يَكْفُرُ بِهَا إِلَّا الْفَاسِقُونَ. Nobody denies the message of Islam except people who are fasiqun. Fasiqun means disobedience, disobedient, rebellient, and resentful of the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what fasiqun is. And it is the same word used here in Surah Al-Ma'idah. So whenever you find somebody who receives the message and tells you it is clear what the message is, I understand the message, but I am not going to accept it, you have to look for this, al-fisq, disobedience, rebellion. Is he afraid for his money? Is he afraid for his position? Is he afraid for his power? Is he afraid for anything? And he gives weight to any of these livelihood issues over his fate in the hereafter. It's a choice that Allah has given everybody. We cannot blame anyone for not accepting the message that is offered to every human being. It's offered for us to choose to accept it or not to accept it. مَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Let him who would like to believe, let him believe. And let those who don't like to believe, let them not believe. It's a choice. It's not imposition. It is not by the force, it's not by the sword. It is a word, it's not a sword. Then I want to take you here to this message. Can you see it? Is it too far? I will read it for you. This is the panel that you see in the picture, is a European Court of Human Rights. Okay? What were they discussing? They were discussing a case of a woman, right-wing woman, who wanted to hold some activity somewhere, and she was deliberately holding it to just insult the Prophet ﷺ. And the place, the hall, rejected her message of hate, and she leveled a case against the place in the court, claiming freedom of expression. And here is what the court says. The court says, insulting Prophet Muhammad in Europe can land you in jail. Why is that? I'm sorry, I need to take it. Okay, it says, insulting Prophet Muhammad can land you in jail. It does not fall under protected free expression. It doesn't get protection. And this was published in a magazine called The Mill Chronicle in Austria, and it was published in October 2015. So it looks like there is a law and a court precedent, at least in Europe, specifically about insulting Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Macron and people like him, they would like to just do what early pagans used to do. Early pagans used to make idols of softened dates, what's called in Arabic agwa, pressed date. They make it into idols. And when they are hungry, they eat it. So what is the relevance here? The relevance is Macron was very, very angry when President Erdogan told him, go check your mental capacity. You don't seem to be in full control. You don't know what you're saying. And he did not spare himself. He couldn't hold his anger. So he called the Turkish ambassador to rebuke him. And he called back the French ambassador from Turkey. This is angry for himself. And when it comes to Muslims being angry at insulting the Prophet ﷺ, he doesn't see it. This is eating his agwa. So on one hand, this is freedom of expression to insult the Prophet, but there is no freedom of expression to insult Macron. This is eating his agwa. This is something we need to call these people to task. And this is not the only incident. There were other incidents. The same magazine terminated a journalist who made a cartoon but criticizing how France looks at freedom. They kicked him out. He didn't finish the month. They didn't give him a chance. This is eating their agua. Okay. The worst claim they seem to be saying and repeating frequently is that Islam spread by the sword, right? But let me take you here. And I'm not going to read the whole script, but I'm showing it for you so that you can read it later on. It's Luke 22. You can read the end part of the chapter, verses 34 and on. The part I want you to focus with me here is, this is happening when Jesus knew that the Roman soldiers are out to arrest him and to crucify him. Okay? So he's talking to his disciples as to what he expects and what he wants them to do. So, verse 36. Then he said unto them, but now he who has a purse, let him take it, which means pick your bag. You will go for something. But now, yes, and likewise his scrip. And he that has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. It is a legitimate request. It is a request for self-defense, and it is a request to face the oppression of the Roman Empire. It's legitimate. Nobody could say anything, right? Okay. For I say unto you that this is that is written must be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. And they said, this is their answer, Lord, behold, here are two swords. And he said unto them, it's enough. You can read the word it's enough to mean two swords are enough. Can you believe that Jesus really means two swords are gonna face the soldiers of the empire? Of course, he was disappointed. Only two people had swords and nobody else, at least among the 13, right? So where is the point that we can learn from this vis-a-vis Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his situation? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the companions came from Medina pledging their faith, and they asked him, what do you want from us? He said, to protect me from my enemies as you would protect your families and your children. Do you pledge? They said, yes, we do. It's the same as they told him, yes, we will. Then they looked around and they only came back with two swords. Muhammad's community, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was ready to defend him with all what they had and with what they didn't have. That's the difference. In both cases, it is self-defense. In both cases, the Prophet is oppressed. In both cases, the community is oppressed. The faithful are about to be decimated, and they badly needed a defense mechanism that was available in their hands. And this is what happened. So Islam did not spread by the sword. It was defended by the sword, but it was spread by the word of Allah. So after the encounter, during the encounter, Isa alayhi salam, it says, and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. He is submitting to Allah, telling Allah, you take care of this your way, but finally and ultimately, I accept your will, whatever this may be. Very important message, okay? So I think that my time, as usual, is running up. Inshallah, we'll complete next time. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand our deen. May Allah help us understand the Quran and understand what the Quran is telling us about what is going on around us. Ameen.